Hello and welcome to this lesson. In this lesson, I'm going to cover the Amazon EC2 pricing options and various use cases for those different pricing options. So it's quite a bit of a deep dive on these subjects as they do come up quite a lot in exam topics, so you really need to know this. So firstly, let's look at the different types of pricing model there are. We've got on demand. On demand is just the standard rate. There's no discount, there's no commitments. You can use it for things like dev test workloads, anything that's short term or unpredictable. So in that case, you're not committing, but you're also not getting any discounts. So it's just a standard rate. It's very flexible, so it is very useful. When we launch instances in this course, we're just using on demand because we're not running them for very long. If you're running a workload for a longer period, then you've got to start thinking about some other kind of option other than on demand, because you're just not going to get any cost savings there. It's going to be the most expensive option. So next up, we have reserved. In this case, you are committing. So though AWS is mostly about not having any commitments, in this case, you are going to commit, but you'll get a discount for it. That discount can be up to 75%, and you commit for either 1 year or 3 years. And this is for things like your steady state workloads, your line of business applications. They're not going anywhere. They're going to keep running year after year. It's predictable. And therefore, you need to make sure that you get the best pricing model for it. And in this case, it makes a lot of sense to have that commitment with AWS. You can also reserve capacity with reserved instances as well. Next up, we have spot instances. This is where you're actually bidding for unused capacity. So AWS obviously have huge data centers. It's not always fully utilized. And so there's lots of unused capacity, and you can bid on the usage of that unused capacity. In this case, you can get discounts up to 90%. So really big discounts, but there is a catch, of course. And that is that your instances can be terminated at any time, and you do get a short notification before that happens. But in this case, you need workloads to have flexible start times and flexible end times. This is used in situations such as where somebody needs a really cost-effective solution to run a large processing workload. And that workload can actually withstand instances being terminated. So the data needs to be saved or it needs to be replicated somewhere. And the application logic needs to be able to recover from any terminated instances. We then have dedicated instances. This is where you have physical isolation at the host hardware level from instances belonging to other AWS customers. So AWS typically are using shared infrastructure. The infrastructure on which your instances run is shared across many customers. If you need to dedicate your instances to hosts that are not shared with other customers, then this is the option for you. In this case, you pay per instance. Your dedicated instances can be sharing hardware with other instances from your account, but not from other AWS customers. We've then got dedicated hosts. This is a physical server that's dedicated for your use. So you're not sharing it with anybody, and you've got a whole server dedicated just for you. It's going to cost you a lot more. Both of these options are going to be expensive. So you've got to think about, you know, why do you need this? But you might need this for things like socket and core visibility. So some licensing is bound to the CPUs in the physical hosts that your instances run on. And therefore, dedicated hosts means that you can have that visibility and it helps you with licensing. You have host affinity, so you can control where your instances are actually running, which hosts are they running on. You might want to make sure that two particular instances are running on different hosts, and you can do that with a dedicated host. This model is pay per host, so you pay for the whole host rather than the instances running on it, and it's going to be a lot more expensive than any of the other options here. Lastly, we have something called savings plans. This is where you commit to a consistent amount of usage, and this goes across EC2, Fargate, which is a container technology we'll talk about later in the course, as well as Lambda. So in this case, what you're doing is you're saying, I'm going to pay a certain rate, and I'm going to commit for a certain period of time, 1 or 3 years, to using a certain amount of compute capacity. Now let's look at how you actually build. So you actually build per second with a minimum of 1 minute, and that's for Linux instances. And the per second billing is for Amazon Linux and Ubuntu in on-demand, reserved, and spot forms. We then have build per hour. This is a minimum of 1 hour, and this applies to Windows, and it applies to other distributions, such as commercial Linux distributions, such as Red Hat Enterprise Linux and SUSE Enterprise Server. Now, what about the EBS volumes that are attached to your EC2 instances? Well, those are actually billed per second with a minimum of 1 minute. So what about the EBS volumes that are attached to your instances? Well, they're billed per second with a minimum of 1 minute. So let's look at reserved instances in some more detail. Remember that the term is 1 year or 3 years. And you have something called a standard RI, and you have a convertible RI. The standard RI means that you can change availability zones, the instance size if it's Linux, and the networking type. You use the modify reserved instances API action to perform those changes. With a convertible RI, you can change the AZ instance size for Linux and the networking type as well, but you can also change the family, operating system, tenancy, and the payment option. And in this case, you use the Exchange Reserved Instances API action to perform those changes. The payment options can then be all upfront, partial upfront, or no upfront. So you either pay for the entire 1 or 3 years upfront, and that means you'll get the best discount, but not so good for your cash flow. Or you can pay a partial fee upfront and then a monthly payment, or no upfront, which just means a monthly payment. And of course, you don't get quite as much of a discount if you don't put anything down upfront, but that obviously gives you a better cash flow situation as well. When the attributes of an instance that you've launched into your account match the attributes of a reserved instance, that's when the discount gets applied. So that can include the type of instance you're running, the instance type, and it can include the operating system that you're using with that instance. The tenancy is another attribute. So that can be default or dedicated. Remember that dedicated means you're running on dedicated hardware. Lastly, it can be the availability zone and the region. So these are all the attributes that need to match the RI for it to be applied. When you specify an availability zone, you can also reserve capacity in that AZ. But by region, it does not reserve the capacity. But the discount does apply to all availability zones. So let's look at the scheduled RI. Scheduled RI is where you match the capacity reservation to a recurring schedule. There's a minimum of 1,200 hours per year, and you might use this for something like a reporting application. So if that runs for 6 hours a day, 4 days a week, that would be 1,248 hours a year. So what you do is you just pay for 1,248 hours a year and you get your reserved instance discount. And you can just use that within those timeframes. Now, very recently, I've noticed this. AWS seemed to be deprecating this functionality. So they now say that they do not have any capacity for purchasing scheduled reserved instances. Now, I still talk about it because it's definitely on the exam at the moment. It will take a few months before they get rid of those questions and update the exams. So just bear in mind, the exam may not reflect this yet. If you see something mentioning scheduled reserved instances, that means the exam's not updated. Next up, we have the savings plans. So here we have the compute savings plan or the EC2 savings plan. With the compute savings plan, you choose a 1 or 3 year. It's an hourly commitment to usage of Fargate, Lambda, and EC2. Any region, family, size, tenancy, and operating system. With the EC2 savings plan, again, it's a 1 or 3 year commitment. It's hourly usage again to EC2 only and within a selected region and instance family. And you can also use any size, any tenancy, and operating system combination. Let's look at spot instances in some more detail. Here you're bidding for unused capacity and getting a discount of up to 90%. You can launch a spot instance. That's just one or more spot instances. Or you can launch a spot fleet. This is where AWS launches and maintains a specified number of spot And also you can mix in on-demand instances to meet a certain capacity. You then have EC2 Fleet. This is where AWS launches and maintains a specified number of spot, on-demand, and reserved instances all in a single API call. With EC2 Fleet, you can define separate on-demand and spot capacity targets, bids, instance types, and availability zones. So lots of flexibility there. Now you do get a 2-minute warning if AWS need to reclaim capacity, and this is made available via instance metadata and also CloudWatch events. Spot block actually comes up in a few exam questions. With spot block, this is where you can run EC2 instances uninterrupted for 1 to 6 hours. So you're getting a discount, but you also don't get an interruption. So in this case, you just specify the block duration, which is anything from 1 to 6 hours, the number of instances, and then your bid price. Pricing is 30 to 40% less than on demand. So much better than on demand, not anywhere near as good as spot. But if you need to make sure that your instances aren't terminated within that time frame, then spot block is a good idea. Lastly, let's look over dedicated instances and hosts in a bit more detail. So this table just helps you understand the differences because it can be a bit confusing. So with dedicated instances and hosts, it's enabling the use of dedicated physical servers. Remember that with dedicated instances, your instances are running on hardware that other AWS customers are not using, but other instances that aren't dedicated instances in your account can share that hardware. We then have per instance billing, that's for dedicated instances. Per host billing is for dedicated hosts. And then lots of features here which you don't get with dedicated instances. You've got visibility of sockets, cores, and the host ID. Affinity between a host and an instance, so you can choose which instance your host is going to run on. You can target instance placement, and automatic instance placement is for both. And you can add capacity using an allocation request for dedicated hosts. So that's it for this lesson. We've covered a lot of ground, and it's not the most exciting topic, but it really is game for the exam. There's lots of questions in the exam on EC2 pricing. In the next lesson, we're going to look at some particular use cases. We're just going to cover off when you would use each pricing model. So I hope that was useful to you, and I'll see you in the next lesson.